Welcome to EE2003 Computer Organization. In this video, we are going to go over a review of digital systems, but purely restricted to a very high level, sufficient to understand the concepts required for this course. The outline of this video is roughly as follows. We will first look at the origins of digital systems, look at a few representation styles, then go over the basics of combinational logic and sequential logic, and briefly touch upon the different technology parameters or different technology styles that can be used to implement digital systems. So let's start with Boolean logic. This is where digital circuits originated. The idea was brought in order to understand the concept of the laws of reason or the laws of thought. This originated somewhere in the 19th century, but found application to digital circuits in the mid 20th century, in particular, Claude Shannon's work in the 1930s was able to apply Boolean logic to the basics of switching theory in order to understand how telephone exchange switches could work. One of the major reasons why digital systems are popular is their noise resilience and the fact that the reproducibility of computations done using digital systems is high. Analog systems are affected quite significantly by noise, by temperature variations and other environmental conditions. Of course, there are ways to make them robust and resilient to those, but at the end of the day, there will always be some variation from one run to another of an analog experiment. A digital system, on the other hand, has essentially managed to reduce these uncertainties to a discrete set of values, which means that we can now apply formal reasoning and mathematical models based on Boolean algebra to understanding the structure and operation of digital systems. By an interesting application of the idea of binary values, the same two-level system, true or false, was now interpreted as numbers 1 and 0, and therefore by using the place value system, we are able to use the same 0 and 1 values in order to represent a number as a sequence of bits. For example, the bit sequence 0101110 in binary could be expanded as 0 × 2^5 plus 1 × 2^4 plus 0 × 2^3 plus 1 × 2^2 plus 1 × 2^1 plus 0 × 2^0. This gives us a decimal equivalent value, or in other words, it represents a number. Keep in mind that this is purely an interpretation. All that we actually have is just a sequence of bits. The fact that we have chosen to interpret it as a number is what allows us to use the same representation for binary numbers as for the logic equations. The interesting side effect of this, of course, is the fact that arithmetic operations such as addition can now be modeled as logical operations. For example, if we try to add 3 bits together, A, B, and a carry input, the sum of those 3 values is given by S is equal to A XOR B XOR CI, where the XOR operation is the exclusive OR, which has a very clear digital logic definition. Similarly, the carry out can also be defined as a combination of AND and OR operations. This means that we can now start to construct logical circuits that implement arithmetic operations. There are many different representations that can be used for digital systems. The most basic one, of course, is the Boolean equation itself, where the expression to be evaluated is written in terms of a combination of the other variables present in the system. An extension of this is the so-called truth table. A truth table is literally a lookup table, which enumerates all possible input values and correspondingly shows what the outputs can be. So for example, the 3 inputs over here, A, B, and CI, can take on all the combinations 000, 001, etc. up to 111. There are 8 different such combinations, 2^3. For each of those inputs, there is a corresponding value of the S, the sum, and the carry out. We can just enumerate those values, and the complete functionality of those equations is now captured using the truth table. The good thing about truth tables is that they don't really care about what kind of operations we have defined. We don't need to know about AND operations, OR operations, XOR, and so on. Any functionality can be represented by putting in the appropriate value in the truth table. Yet another representation that is common for digital systems is the schematic level, where we actually use logic gates and connect them up with wires. This is a slightly more non-trivial representation of the digital system, in the sense that we have already made an assumption about the types of gates that are available to us. In this diagram, for example, we have assumed that we have two input XOR gates, a three input OR gate, and two input AND gates. Depending on what the technology actually provides to us, the schematic could look different. Now let's look at how these digital logic gates actually get implemented in hardware. The most common technology today is the so-called CMOS technology, complementary metal oxide semiconductor. What we use over here are metal oxide semiconductor transistors, or MOS transistors. The transistor on top over here, this is known as a PMOS transistor, while this is an NMOS transistor, the lower transistor. Now these transistors are used and connected up in such a way that for the inverter at least, what you can see is that one of them, the PMOS, has its source terminal connected to VDD, the drain terminal connected to the output. Similarly, the NMOS transistor has its drain connected to the output and the source terminal connected to ground. The input signal, X, is connected to the gate inputs, gate terminals of both the transistors, and the combined drain terminals are taken out as the output, which we'll label Y. In order to understand how this works, the best thing to do is to think of MOS transistors as switches. A PMOS transistor can be thought of as a switch which is on or activated when its gate terminal has a value of zero attached to it, or a low voltage, a ground signal. Conversely, the NMOS transistor is activated when the gate terminal has a high voltage or VDD applied to it. How does this work in practice? Let's first look at the situation where X is equal to zero. What happens is that the PMOS transistor acts as a switch which is closed, whereas the NMOS transistor is now open. This means that we now have a direct path connecting the supply VDD to the output, and therefore Y becomes equal to 1. This happens when X is equal to 0, of course, and the PMOS transistor is on and the corresponding NMOS transistor is off. Conversely, when we apply X is equal to 1, that is a high voltage at the input, the NMOS transistor turns on while the PMOS transistor is now off. This means that the output terminal Y is now connected to ground, and any charge or any voltage that might be present over there discharges through the NMOS transistor and goes down to ground to zero. And therefore the output becomes zero. Therefore, this combination of two transistors essentially implements a simple inverter functionality. It inverts whatever logic value was there at the input. We can extend the same concept further to more complex gates. For example, the circuit on the right shows a NAND gate. We have two inputs, A and B. The PMOS transistors and the NMOS transistors are connected in such a way that at any given value of A and B, only one of the paths, either the pull-down path through the NMOS transistors or one or both of the pull-up paths through the PMOS transistors, are going to be on. Therefore, we will never have a contention or a short circuit where both the PMOS and the two NMOS transistors are on, leading to a short circuit from VDD to ground. That is why the system is called complementary. The pull-up circuitry corresponding to the PMOS transistors and the pull-down circuitry corresponding to the NMOS are complements of each other, so that at any given set of values of A, B, etc., only one of the two paths will be active. Now, in order to understand the physical characteristics of digital circuits, we need to go a bit deeper. So far, we have been looking at the transistors purely as switches. But in reality, transistors respond to voltage variations across them. The usual way that this is studied is to think in terms of something called the inverter characteristics, where we look at the input voltage that is applied to an inverter and look at the corresponding output voltage. So for example, if I have an inverter, the voltage at the input would be called Vin, and the voltage at the output would be called Vout. What does it look like as I vary Vin slowly And what are the ranges, the maximum and minimum values for Vin and Vout? As we can imagine, Vin can basically go from 0 up to VDD. That is the maximum value that is permitted. And we also assume that the minimum value is 0. That is, we don't consider negative voltages. Correspondingly, because the output is also either pulled up to VDD or pulled down to ground, we can see that the output also varies between 0 and VDD. What we can see over here is that when the input is 0, the output corresponds to VDD, which is one extreme. And at the other extreme, when the input is VDD, the output corresponds to 0. So this essentially corresponds to x equal to 0, y equal to 1, while the other extreme corresponds to x equal to 1, y equal to 0. Now, by looking at this curve, you can notice that it is not a perfect brick wall. In other words, it's not as though the output remains exactly equal to VDD until a certain point and then abruptly switches over to 0 when Vn crosses some threshold. That's what we would probably like in an ideal situation, but that can't happen in practice. What does happen is that we can sort of look at this characteristic and say that we can divide it into separate regions. The topmost part and the bottom part, which have been labeled as noise suppressed, you can think of it as any variation in the Vin will cause only a reduced variation in the Vout, meaning that any change in the input voltage or any fluctuation in the input voltage sort of gets suppressed, and we do not really see a significant effect on the output. The value remains close to either 0 or 1. On the other hand, in the middle region, which has been marked as noise amplified, we find that any small change in the value of VDD will cause a large change in the output. In other words, the output tries to very quickly switch over from 0 to 1 or from 1 to 0, depending on how the input is changing. In the ideal situation, of course, we would like the slope of the curve in that region to be infinite, but in general, we would like it to be as large as possible so that the range of input values over which it remains in an uncertain state is kept as small as possible. The midpoint value where Vout is equal to Vin is also an important characteristic of the inverter that we are usually interested in finding, and typically we would like this to be as close to VDD by 2 as possible. All this so far we have been talking about combinational circuits, where we essentially look at a combination of inputs in order to generate the output. This means that the output is dependent only on the present set of inputs. On the other hand, there can be situations where we are interested in storing data, where the output would depend not just on the present inputs, but also on previous values of the inputs or the previous state of the system. The question becomes, what kind of logic circuits could implement such functionality? The most basic approach that we can do in order to understand this is to use one technique, which is usually called feedback, or the construction of something called a bistable element. The circuit over here shows two inverters that are connected back to back. The inverters are labeled I1 and I2. And one point, the output of I1, is labeled as Y, and that is called the output. And if you look carefully, you'll realize that there is actually no input to this system. So how does this pair of inverters work? Let's draw the voltage transfer characteristics. We are going to label the two points, the input of I1 as V1 and the output of I1 as V2, which means that the input of I2 is going to be V2 and the output of I2 is going to be V1. So what does that mean? It means that we can plot both of these characteristics on the same set of axes. What we have is the voltage transfer characteristic, or VTC, of I1 looks like this, the familiar inverter characteristic. But what happens to I2? If we plot it on the same set of axes, we'll find that it looks something like this, because now V2 and V1 are interchanged. The input and output are interchanged. We have essentially taken the output of one and connected as the input of the other, which means that we now need to take these intersections of these two characteristic curves, and that in turn tells us that there are so-called operating points. In particular, we can see that the value where V1 is equal to 0 and V2 is equal to VDD is one stable operating point corresponding to the value Y equal to 1. Similarly, V1 equal to VDD, therefore V2 equal to 0, corresponds to the stable operating point where Y is equal to 0. The reason why these are called stable operating points is that if there is a slight variation in V1 around the value of 0, as we know, the output change V2 is going to be very small. that in turn means that we have essentially got a very small change in the V2, which will ultimately result in pushing it back, pushing V1 back towards the value zero. So in other words, any noise that we have will get suppressed in this range. On the other hand, there is also one more possible operating point or intersection of these two curves, which corresponds to the value essentially close to Vout equal to, essentially Vout equal to Vin in this case. This is an unstable operating point. As we saw earlier, any noise in this range is going to be amplified, which means that if I'm starting from a small value of V1 and moving towards a large value, any delta in V1 at this point will cause a large change in the V2, which in turn will correspondingly amplify further and will rapidly push the system either towards the V1 equal to zero or the V1 equal to VDD operating points. Therefore, such a system, a bistable system, has two stable operating points and one unstable operating point. The interesting thing is, even without any input, the Y will hold a value of zero or one, whatever was applied to it at some point in time, as long as power is given to the system. In other words, it has achieved our requirement of being able to store a value. Storing a value by itself inside a bistable circuit is not useful unless we also have some way by which we can change the value stored inside the circuit. This can be done by introducing two new switches into the system. We use a gate signal G, which is connected to two switches, one with positive polarity and the other with negative polarity, as shown in the figure. When G is equal to zero, the switch with negative polarity is closed, and therefore the feedback loop is set up and the circuit operates in storage mode. On the other hand, when G is equal to one, the feedback loop is broken and X is connected to the input of the inverter on top, and therefore Y becomes equal to X bar, and that value will remain over there until G once again becomes equal to zero. Such a structure is usually called a positive level triggered latch. The reason is that it responds to the level of G. Whenever G is equal to zero, Y remains unchanged. But when G is equal to one, Y follows the value present in X. In other words, Y is equal to X bar for that duration. Similarly, we can also construct a negative level triggered latch, where the only difference is the polarities applied to the switch in the feedback loop and outside the feedback loop. In other words, whenever G is equal to zero, Y will follow X, but when G is equal to one, it will hold the last value that was seen. By combining two such level triggered latches together, we can construct something which is called an edge triggered flip-flop, which turns out to be more useful from the point of view of analyzing digital circuits and making circuits that are easier to design and analyze. Let's look at a waveform in order to understand how this works. The C signal, which is usually referred to as the clock, can be thought of as a sort of square wave, something which changes from 0 to 1, back to 0, and back to 1, and so on. What we want is that the values at Q, the output, should change only at very specific time instants and should take the value of D corresponding to those time instants. Over here, D changes multiple times. As you can see, it goes from 0 to 1, back to 0, and 1 multiple times within the two clock cycles of C that we have shown. Now let's look at what happens to X. Whenever C is equal to zero, we find that the first latch is transparent, meaning that X will follow D. Right? So what we find is, during those portions where C is equal to zero, the value of X follows the value of D. On the other hand, as can be seen over here, we find that even though D has changed before C became equal to zero, it's only when C becomes equal to zero that X takes on that value. What does this imply for Q? Remember that Q is determined by the second latch, which in turn is controlled by C equal to one. Therefore, only when C becomes equal to one is Q allowed to change. This means that it will basically correspond to the edges of the clock signal, and any change in Q can only happen corresponding to a clock edge. In this way, we have achieved what we wanted, which is to say that the value of Q can change only at very specific time instants, which are determined by a clock edge. rather than a time duration, which would be determined by the entire time that c is equal to 0 or c is equal to 1. This is one way by which we can realize the edge triggered behavior. There are other methods, but this is a common and simple way of implementing it. Similar to latches, we can also think of positive edge triggered flip-flops. By the way, flip-flops are also generally known as registers, and the term register usually refers to an edge triggered flip-flop. So in future, we'll be using the term edge triggered flip-flop and register interchangeably. So a positive register or a positive edge triggered flip-flop is one where the output responds on a 0 to 1 transition of the clock signal. Similarly, a negative edge triggered flip-flop is one that responds to a 1 to 0 transition on the clock signal. Now, edge triggered flip-flops can also have an enable signal attached to them. This might, for example, be useful when a clock signal is continuously applied to a register, but we don't always want its value to change. We want to be able to control when the value at D gets copied through to the output and when it just retains the last value that it has. How can we do this? One way would be to sort of gate out the clock signal. We force the clock signal to be equal to 0 whenever CE is equal to 0, right? So we could use an AND gate, for example, to do that. That is generally not advisable because clock signals are very sensitive parts of the circuit. They are distributed across the entire circuit and are typically quite high load and difficult to route properly across an entire circuit. So putting in extra gates in the clock path is generally not advisable. Another way by which the same functionality could be achieved is to use a multiplexer instead. Over here, what we do is we basically have the D signal going through a multiplexer into the edge triggered flip-flop. The multiplexer itself, the select signal of the multiplexer is controlled by the CE signal. So when CE is equal to 1, whenever there is a clock edge, the value at D will be copied through to Q. On the other hand, whenever CE is equal to 0, even if there is a clock edge, Q will just hold the last value that it saw. We can go further with this and take a group of flip-flops and combine them together by applying the same clock and the same CE signal, but giving multiple data values. For example, D3, D2, D1, D0 could be a 4-bit number. And since we have connected the same CE and the same clock to all the four flip-flops, they will operate in unison. All the four values Q3, Q2, Q1, Q0 will get updated or not at exactly the same time. This is usually represented more compactly by this bus notation, where we just put a slash and the number of bits corresponding to the bus on the wire in order to indicate that it's a multi-bit bus. We can go further with registers and create an array of registers. We apply the same clock signal to all of them. But now, what are the things that we would like to do? One might be that we want to actually select out or read the value from one of the registers alone. How do we do that? We take all the four Q outputs and put them through a multiplexer, which gives out just one of the Q outputs. Remember that each of these Q values themselves could be 4 or 8 or 16 or 32 bits. We don't care about the number of bits. The multiplexer, if it takes in 4 n-bit values, will give out 1 n-bit value. That's the understanding here. On the other hand, the address selection that is required for the multiplexer is determined by only the number of distinct input values that we are trying to select from. In this case, there are 4, which means that we need a 2-bit select signal to determine the output. So in this way, we call this the read address, something that's given to the multiplexer to select out which of these 4 values, Q3, Q2, Q1, Q0, comes through to the output. What about updating the values of the registers? Here, if I want to write something into a register, what I would do is I take the value to be written, D, and apply it to all the 4 registers. Okay. Now, how do we prevent all 4 of them from getting updated at the same time? Use the CE signal. Okay. And the simplest way to do that is once again generate the write address, which is once again a 2-bit select signal. But now put that through a decoder circuit. The decoder works such that the 4 outputs of the decoder, at any point in time, only one of them will become equal to 1. All the others will be 0. We could also have a situation where all 4 of them remain 0 so that none of the values get updated. Right? that's easy enough to extend the decoder functionality. But by doing it in such a way that at any point, only one of these four values will be equal to zero or will be equal to one, we can control which of Q3, Q2, Q1, or Q0 will change and will take on the value that is there in D. In this way, we now have an array of registers into which we can write selectively and we can also read out selectively. Note that because of the way we have just used the multiplexer in order to read, we could have more than one multiplexer with the same values connected to it. And by giving different addresses, we can read multiple values from the registers at the same time. We could also have a situation where we can try to think of writing multiple values at the same time, but that's more complicated. You will also have to sort of multiplex which of the values need to get written and so on. On the other hand, being able to read more than one value and write one value all at the same time in the same clock cycle is very useful, as we will see later. We can extend the idea of register arrays further to generate large arrays, which we call memory blocks. In this case, what we have is the select signals are now explicitly called an address. We now have a W data, which takes care of writing data into the memory block, and R data, which is the data read out of the memory block. The structures for these would be similar to what we saw earlier in the case of the simple arrays. We also have a read and write enable signal, which explicitly makes it clear whether we are trying to read from the memory block or write into the memory block. And in addition to all of these signals, we could also have one more signal called a chip enable, which essentially activates or deactivates the entire block. The reason for having such a signal is so that we can now, for example, combine multiple blocks together such that when we have two blocks of, let's say, 1 kilobyte each, we take the bottom 10 bits of the address bus and connect it to both of the memory blocks. But the address 10, the 10th bit of the address bus, will be connected either in the positive or negative polarity to the two blocks, which means that when address of 10 is equal to 0, the top memory block is selected. But when address of 10 is equal to 1, the bottom memory block is selected. In this way, we can create larger and larger blocks of memory and increase the total amount of memory that can be addressed. Of course, the total addressable space is determined by the number of bits in the address bus. The good thing about memory blocks is that, unlike register files, they may not directly be implemented using flip-flops. There are much more compact and efficient ways directly at the transistor level by which we can implement these large arrays and thereby get a huge amount of memory in a relatively small space. So to summarize sequential elements, the most important ones as far as we are concerned are the edge-triggered flip-flops or registers. We also need to know about level-triggered latches, although we will try to avoid using them as far as possible. We saw that there are arrays of registers which are useful and will be useful in the designs as we move forward. And of course, there is also the concept of memory, which is very high capacity and is also typically designed directly at the transistor level to have high density and has this notion of addressing that allows us to directly select or deselect parts of the circuit.